got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. The valleys that I wander turn to mountains that I can't climb. You are with me, you never leave me. Cause there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflow cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel beat. It's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. Clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel beat. Cause it's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation, and it's beautiful. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation, and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing, cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Oh, mercy. Creator of all things, healer of my being. Through your righteousness, I've been redeemed. Of all things, healer of my being. Through your righteousness, I've been redeemed. Forgiven by your grace, your joy is my strength. When everything has changed, you stay the same. You are God, bright and morning star. When I'm down, you lift me up. You're the lover of my heart. You are God, mender of my soul. You're the rain that makes me whole. You are God. Ever-present help, Savior of my life. Everything I have belongs to you. My time is in your hands. My purpose is your will. I know that you'll provide, so I'll be still. You are God, bright and morning star. When I'm down, you lift me up. You're the lover of my heart. You are God, mender of my soul. You're the rain that makes me whole. You are the one that delivers me. It's not because of what I am, but who you are. You are God, bright and morning star. When I'm down, you lift me up. You're the lover of my heart. You are God. my soul. You're the rain that makes me whole. You are God, bright morning star. When I'm down, you lift me up. You're the lover of my heart. You are God, mender of my soul. You're the rain that makes me whole.
You are God.
You're my provider. When I'm down, you lift me higher. When I'm weak, you are the fire. It turns me into gold. You are God, Alpha, Omega. Take my life, Lord, I surrender. You're the rain that makes me whole. You are God. That's been a while. Just a little while longer, I wanna pray. Can't get you off my mind, so I came to say thank you, Lord, just for loving me. Many times I do forget every need that you have met. Oh, thank you, Lord, I know you're showing me. You are there when I am down and out. You're holding me. Your love is so amazing. Oh, it changed me. Here I am with all I have. Raise my hands to worship you. I want to say thank you. Oh, thank you for everything, for who you are. You cover me, you touch my heart. I want to say thank you. Could have died in my sin, but you saved me. Didn't have any hope at all. You gave me peace divine, strength to carry on. Should have been the one to pay, but instead you took my place. Amazing grace, it's more than just a song. Even though I don't deserve your love for me, you look beyond my fault and you show me mercy. Here I am with all I have. Raise my hands to worship you. I want to say thank you. Oh, thank you for everything, for who you are. You cover me, you touch my heart. I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you for the sun. Lord, we thank you for the rain. Lord, thank you for the love you give. Here I am with all I have. Raise my hands to worship you. I want to say thank you. Thank you for everything, for who you are. You cover me, you touch my heart. I want to say thank you. Thank you, I want to say thank you. Thank you, you. I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you. Pastor.
No. Before they start waving at me in the back, I'll turn that on. There's no more appropriate song that we can have than one that says, thank you. This time of year, we need to just give him thanks. Honor him in all things. Let him have his way. As I looked at that song list this morning, I said, Lord, you must have known exactly what I was supposed to speak, and I thought she had a copy of my notes. But we didn't talk or anything. Too many times, we as the children of God say things that we don't mean. Too many times, we mean things that we don't do. That's a sad edict, but the glorious redemption of that is pretty simple. And that is, there's restoration and renewal and power and presence that can come to us even when we fail. And that's such an exciting, exciting thing. Oh, they are here. They weren't up with me this morning. I missed them. Do we have Sunday school? We got it covered? Okay. I'm excited about this morning, and I want to start out with a true story. A story that is fairly old, but nevertheless has a valuable context. The story was first written in national newspapers to honor a man. And we'll find out who that man is here in just a minute. But it goes like this. In 1958, a man by the name of Robert Lane had a son and named him Winner. Everyone questioned why he would do, or excuse me, I missed the part of my notes, you that have notes. I missed the paragraph, but I know what it is. A few years later, he had another son and named him Loser. Everyone questioned why he would doom his son by naming him Loser. Contrary to everyone's expectation, Loser Lane succeeded. After graduating from college, he later became a sergeant with the NYPD. Nowadays, no one calls him Loser. He goes by the name of Lou. Loser Lane became successful. What about that brother with the can't-miss name? His most notable achievement is the sheer length of his criminal record, inmate number 00R2807. What people name you does not define you. What people call you does not define you. But Jesus himself defines you. And with that, I want to take you to Matthew chapter 21, to a very short parable this morning. A very short parable. I'm going to try to be nice. I'm going to try to get done and let you out early today. Now, the key word in that, anybody got it? Try. So there's no promise. So don't go. Pastor say, no, I'm going to try. Matthew 21, verses 28 through 31, it's a parable of the two sons. But what do you think? It starts out, what do you think? A man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, son, go work today in my vineyard. And he answered and said, I will not. But afterward he regretted it and went. Then he came to the second son and said, likewise. And he answered and said, I will go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said to him, the first. The problem with that is they had it all wrong. Blaise Pascal said this, there are only two kinds of people. The righteous who think they're sinners and the sinners who think they are righteous. Isn't that interesting? The righteous who think they are sinners, and sinners who think they're righteous. Which are you? I would say if we would define that, we would find out that we're part of both. Most of us are righteous who have been sinners. But we have a problem with forgiveness, not that God has forgiven us, but forgiving ourselves, so we think we're still sinners. And on the other hand, some of us think that we're sinners, or we're righteous, but we're living in sin. Because we're not following what God's calling is for our life. I would ask this morning, are you the first or second son? Neither one of them really did the will of the Father. But here's the kicker. There was always time for restoration. No matter what your condition this morning, God has restoration for you. The short and powerful parable is told in two acts. It seems like a winner from the start, and the other seems like a loser from the start. Let me tell you something, and let me give it to you real quick, and I'll give you the end. You ready? There are no losers with God. Only winners. You may have the name loser, but you are successful and overcomer in Christ Jesus this morning. You may have the name winner and end up in prison. I said last week, and I've said before, that I was talking to one of the people that wasn't supposed to make it in ministry from my class. And by the way, there are five of us that were not supposed to make it. We had loser written all over us. Now let me explain something. Every one of those five are still in active ministry today. There were three that were proclaimed winners. Oh, these guys that got it all together. One lasted 2 years. One lasted 5 years. And I believe the other one lasted 8 or 10 years. Every one of the winners weren't winners. And I had a chance to talk with one of them several years ago. And he said, I wish I would have hung in there. I wish I would have stayed. I've been miserable ever since. I've been neglecting my calling. And I had the opportunity to tell him, quote unquote, there's always time to be restored. And last I heard, he was working towards that and coming into restoration and being an active help to the pastor of the church that he was attending. And even starting to begin to minister again. You might have winter all over your head, or you might have people going like this. But with God, all things are possible. Jesus starts this parable out with the two sons with a question. What do you think? How many of you have ever said these words? Well, that's what I get for thinking. That's what I get for thinking. Here's the father, and he says to the first son, go work today in my vineyard. The call. God calls every one of us. Matter of fact, there's a portion of Scripture that says, many are called, but what? Few are chosen. Calling. The Father says in this verse, go work in my vineyard today. And the Son says, no. I will not. How many of you have ever gotten an attitude with God? God, I'm not going to do that. That's fine. We'll see. Because God will always begin to do something within your life to bring restoration and power and things. And he'll always bring you back to a point to make the decision the right way. That's the reason why so many people keep running around in circles in their spiritual life. Because they haven't figured out to make the right decision. To get on the next loop. You know, so I'm going to say this morning at the risk of offending you. You know, a spiritual life is like a loop-de-loop roller coaster. You keep going around the loops, until you get it right. And sometimes you feel topsy-turvy. Sometimes you get sick. You know, it's not fun to be behind somebody that gets sick on a roller coaster because you got a duck. You catching what I'm saying? Let's all get well spiritually. So you don't have to make the other person behind you duck. So that they can grow too. The son says, I will not, as his response, and then begins immediately to become convicted. The son reconsiders and goes to work in the vineyard. He brings repentance. Return. And this is where the disciples get all messed up. Well, he repented and he returned. Well, that's good. But as the parable says, which of the two did the will of his father? And they said to him, the first. Not really. Because the will of the father was, when he said go to the vineyard, was to go without complaint. Here's the problem. And I'm not going to say 99%. I'm going to say 100% of us. Because all of us have failed the Lord in some manner and not did what he's told us to do. And by that, lost the will of the Father. Now there is a time of reconnection, restoration that comes. And the good encouragement, which we'll get to in just a minute in this parable, will tell us something that's very important. Father sees the second son and tells him, go work in the field, the call. The son answers, yes, sir, I will go, but didn't. We sing the song, I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord. I'll do what you want me to do. And then you're praying the next day, and the Lord gives you an assignment, and you say, that's got to be for somebody else. The Lord gives you an assignment, and he said, because you reject, and your life becomes a lie when you tell the Lord that you'll do something and don't do it. Now, we don't know the final result of the second son. But we do know that there was restoration for him available as well as the first. Which of the two did the will of the Father? The first, they answered, they didn't get it. They didn't get what Jesus was talking about. Because we see Act 2. And I've named this, how will you respond? How will you respond? The second half of Matthew chapter 1, verse 31 and 32 said this, Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that the tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you. And John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But tax collectors and harlots believed him. And when you saw it, you did not afterward relent and believe. He was talking to the religious leaders that day and said, you're like the second son. Wow. You put on the name, religious leader, but reject who I am. John came to you in the way of righteousness and you didn't believe him. Jesus comes to you in the way of righteousness and you will not believe him. The Holy Spirit calls you to be a righteous person and you don't do what God's called you to do. Well, that's pretty scathing, isn't it? Pretty scathing. Even when you've seen the others believe, you did not relent or repent and believe. You didn't do it. You didn't believe me. And then Jesus, in his love, says, that's fine. Because I've got something for you. And I want to do an explanation and an encouragement about this parable this morning that just hit me. See, this little parable contains both a warning and an encouragement. The warning is when God tells you to do something, do it. I had a mom that I would know that I had three times before I had to do something. Any of you experienced that or done that yourself? At three times, she could tell me the first time and I could blow it off. She could tell me the second time and I could kind of wake up and get it. But if she got to that third time, I knew I was in trouble. Many parents go, okay, this is what I want you to do. And then they start, one, two. And a minute they start, three, they're gone to do what they need to do. Why? Because they know what's coming after three. That's the way we're at with God. The warning is to simply talk a good game or to start out well is not enough. Jesus wants you to keep going. I'm not a marathon runner, but I know a guy who is a fairly good marathon runner. For the past 30-some years, he has been the spiritual advisor and the track coach at Kenyon College. He graduated, I think, with Becky. His name is Dwayne Gomez. Dwayne used to talk about marathon running. The first 3 to 5 miles is great. It's easy. Then you get into that 10-mile zone, the 10 to 13-mile zone, and you hit a wall. And literally, when you first hit that wall, you want to die. You want to quit. But then you have to have a mindset, I need to keep pushing. And then after you get through that pushing stage, you get what's called a second wind. Now, don't ask me. I cannot tell you, because I have never ran a marathon and don't plan on it. Okay? I'm lucky if I can run here to the parking lot. But what I'm saying to you is you get that second wind and then you feel like going. And then about the 20-mile mark, you hit that again. And you've got to tell your mind, I got to press on. I got to press on. I got to press on. Until you cross the finish line. That's the way it is with your spiritual life. You'll have times where it's free, it's easy. And then you'll have times where you hit the wall and you feel like you're going to die. But God is good. He'll keep you going. See, the encouragement of this parable is for those of us who have said and done things we regret, we have a Savior who has forgiveness for us. How many of you have done anything or said anything that you regret? You know? I heard a long time ago the statement that you probably all heard, saying simply, open mouth, insert foot. You know? Sometimes I open my mouth and not only just insert the foot, I just get the leg all the way up to the knee. Regret. Anger. Frustration. Whatever it is. And then we condemn ourselves. How many just walk around feeling condemned because you didn't do something that you should have done? And then God says, wait a minute. He says, understand something, and I want to repeat something from Romans that's not in the notes, but it says this: there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. You are forgiven. See, let's go back to that Luke parable for just a minute. And I want you to look at that and tell me something that happened. When that first son went back and repented and went to the vineyard to work and began to work anything, did the father mention anything to him about the conversation in the morning? Absolutely not. What did he do? He welcomed them in, said, come on in. I need all the help I can get. I need you. And I'm going to say something that's a little bit different for your mindset this morning. But Jesus needs you to work in your vineyards. There's an old song from the 1970s that I wish I had on tape that I could play for you. Who will work in my fields? Jesus desires that you come to the field. The encouragement for the things that we regret is that we have a Savior who has forgiveness for us. Now this next line that I'm going to give you, if you don't get anything else, get it. You ready? Good endings come from bad beginnings. Good endings come from bad beginnings. It's another way of saying something that I've told you before and before and before. If something is worth doing, it's worth doing badly. Why? Because if you just do it, you will end up getting better. You didn't learn to walk all of a sudden. You might have took one step or two steps and down you went. Your spiritual life is the same way. You need to do it. Well, I don't, can't do it. I'm. Shut up and do it. I was with my cousin yesterday for a little while, or my nephew yesterday for a little while. And he was on call at his work. And he came to have lunch with us for a few minutes. And when he came to have lunch with us, one of his printing presses went down at work. And so they called him and they called the person that went to fix it. And he was texting the person that was the maintenance person that had to go in and fix it. And they call him Hillbilly. And he puts on, thank you, Hillbilly, for going in. Hillbilly is kind of just straightforward. And the reply to his text, thank you, was, shut up. I don't want to go, but I'm going. So just shut up. Think about it. Isn't that like us? I don't want to do it, God. I'm going. I don't want to do it. Good endings come from bad beginnings. You'll never learn unless you start. You'll listen to this. You'll never return unless you go back. You'll never return unless you go back to Calvary. Go back to your calling. Wow. God is more interested in your present decisions than in your past failings. You know what? The past is a past. Forget about it. You can't change it. But the future is wide open. Understand, what was true of you back then does not have to, nor should it control you now. What was true of you yesterday does not have to, nor should it control you now. When the initially rebellious son shows up at the vineyard, the father does not chastise him about the earlier conversation. Jesus will never ask you about your failures. He will encourage you about his promise. He will never ask you about your failures, but he will encourage you about your promise. He will always open a door for you to fulfill what he has called you to do. The question is, are you willing to open the door? Becky and I love a program called Long Lost Family. And I'm a softie. I don't know if how many of you have seen Long Lost Family? It's about children that have been separated by adoption and stuff. They're looking for their father or their mother, or they're looking for their brothers or their sisters or whatever. And the part that gets me every time is the part at the end of the program when they're about ready to be reunited with their sibling or their parent. They walk to the door and they stop. They knew that restoration was right on the other side of the door. Then you see them reach and they pause because they're afraid to open the door. Till they finally open the door and restoration becomes complete. How many of you today are standing at the door of restoration, afraid to open the door and walk through the door and get the blessing that you deserve and that God has for you? He's not worried about what you've done or how long you've been gone or whatever. What he's saying to you is come home. Come home. He welcomes the Son to do the Father's will. Come on. See, the Father was ready to welcome anyone who was coming to do the Father's will, regardless of their past. Many of you have passed this morning. Some of them checkered. Some of them not quite right. Some of them bad. I'm going to tell you something. The little angel that I was, I hold a record you guys can never break. You want to know what it was? I was kicked out of Sunday school. Think about that one. Anybody else been there? And I was kicked out of Sunday school because I told the teacher something that he should never have heard. Some of you have told God something that he should never have heard, and you think that God has kicked you out, but God is saying, no, you sit in that seat, and you learn, and you be convicted until you welcome back, and you decide to come back and work in the vineyard. It's the reason why I never give up on people, because there are people that never give up on me that kept praying. There's people right now I'm praying for that I'm not giving up on. And that goes right down to the closest person in my family that I've got left, my brother. It goes down for some of your family members that I know of that God has put a burden on my heart for. And I keep saying, God, why? And he keeps saying, none of your business, keep praying. See, the Father's ready to welcome us. The parable is about the power to change. But even more, it's about actions that come from authentic belief. And I'm going to say something that's hard. But it's true. True belief leads to believing actions. True belief causes you to walk in faith. True belief says, Lord, I'm going to step through the door. What am I saying? I'm saying that's something that's very tough. There's a difference between authentic belief and just believing. When Jesus asked the question, do you believe? And the people said, Lord, we believe. And Jesus turned to them and said, well, that's good. The devils believe and they tremble. Some of us need to come to a trembling point that forces us to open the door of opportunity and blessing and power within our life. True belief leads to believing action. The parable of the two sons is a mirror meant to help us reflect on our own lives. Maybe it's an area where you're not currently in the vineyard. Maybe the Father's invited you to the vineyard and you're out. You've said, no, I'm not going. And God's convicting you and He wants to lead you back into what He wants you to do and become what He wants you to be. Maybe you have good intentions. I'll go, but you never show up. My mama used to tell me good intentions will lead you straight to hell, son. Turn around. Head to the vineyard. Maybe you're not currently in the vineyard, but this morning you can make a decision to turn and go towards it. Or maybe you have patterns of deceit in your life that God needs to deliver you from. Yeah, I believe, but you really don't. See, there's something that goes with belief, authentic belief, that you need to know, and that's trust. And we, as a people, have learned really quickly how not to trust people. And therefore, we have established that so much of an ingrained belief within our life that we cannot trust God. Lord, I believe, so I'll trust you. But Lord, I'm struggling. I'm making it. I'm struggling, but I'm making it. I'm coming, but I'm making it. I'm all right, Lord. I'm doing that. And we will stay in this continual, just making it, struggling sense. Until we learn to trust Him and do what He tells us to, open the door and walk into blessing. Lord, I believe you. But do I really trust you? Lord spoke to me about that. It hurt. Because if I'm preaching to anybody this morning, I'm preaching to myself more than you. I'm finding out that God tells me something, but I won't trust Him enough to do it. That's tough. Jesus is saying to me, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man opens the door, I will come into him and sup with him and he with me. But because I can't trust him, I can't open the door. Some of you are in that same situation right now. Maybe you know, and I put that in my notes, that word know in capital letters. Maybe you know that God's calling you to figure out what's true about him. But you keep making excuses or letting less important things take up your life. Paul said, "For I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that." I know God's called me. I'm sure of it. Some of you know God's called you to do certain things, and you're sure of it. But you keep making excuses. You keep letting less important things take up your life. When God says, open the door. And let me tell you, the more he deals with you, the wider the door gets. What am I saying? I believe for some of us, we have a double door, garage door, that God wants to open so we can walk through it so we have no doubt. Because the opportunity is there. It's not just a little tiny thing. But it's a door wide enough that we can be assured we could drive a semi through it. Hear me. Do you know God's calling you? Figure out what's true about him? Absolutely. Let's quit making excuses. Letting less important things take up our life. What area is God calling you to get to the vineyard? Trusting that his will for you is good. What's the area? Maybe about witnessing. Maybe about establishing your personal life with Jesus a little bit better. Maybe about encouraging. See, one of the least, you ready for this one? One of the least ministries that is done today that God has asked people to do is encouraging one another. We'd rather rip them down instead of build them up. What area is God calling you to get into the vineyard? Learn to trust that his will for you is good. The choice is yours. And I'm going to list off about 5 things that we need to stop doing and then give you a quote that I'm going to be in. The choice is yours. You can say, yes, Lord, do your work in me. That's the easy way. And that's a good way. But when you say, yes, Lord, do your work in me, here's 5 things you got to stop doing. You ready? First thing you got to do is stop resisting. Stop resisting because you're going anyway. You're bought with a price. You're his child. You can either go or resist and be miserable. The second thing that I have to say to the Lord is after I stop resisting is I need to stop evading. Evading. We're like the young man with a warrant running from the cops. You folks, you ready? You are a person with a calling. Why are you running from the Lord? Because pretty soon you're going to get caught. and arrested. By that I mean stop dead in your track so that you move into the right way. Loser Lane was a winner. Winner Lane had a rap sheet. How long's your rap sheet with God? Whoa, wait a minute. How long's your rap sheet with God? Serve your time, get paroled, and get on the right way, and get restored. Stop evading. Third, stop denying. Lord, I don't think you can use me. Oh, get out of here. Give me a break. Sorry, in the Old Testament, and I'm going to use the word, and forgive me for it, he used an ass to wake up people. You're better than that, I would hope. That donkey spoke to that man, whoa, hey, what happened? Stop denying. Because the word says, I have a plan for you, a plan for good and not for evil. Fourthly, stop pretending. Be real. Be real. I freely tell people that a lot of these things that I get from the Lord or somebody else's outline. But then the Lord speaks to me on where I need to go with it. I'm not as smart as you guys think. I'm just a good reader. What am I saying to you? Stop pretending. See, I've been through the high school thing. Been through the college thing. If I pretend I don't know what I'm doing, they'll mean let me slide. God knows. The pretending needs. In the fifth one, stop procrastinating. Stop putting it off. Stop putting it off. Because God wants to bring you into blessing. When we commit to these things, we'll ultimately walk in restoration and the blessing that God has for you and I. Are you ready? Are you ready to walk in blessing? Are you ready to walk in His purpose? Are you ready to go to the vineyard? Whether you said, Lord, I'll go and haven't went, there's always time to get there. Whether you said, I won't go, and you've been kicking yourself, turn around and get there. Let me tell you, the word says there's none righteous, no, not one. None of us have it together. Let's not pretend, let's procrastinate, let's not deny. Let's not evade or resist, but let's move forward. This morning I'm going to ask you a question, because I believe that we're all at the door and we all got our hand reaching out and on the door handle. Are you ready to turn that door handle and open the door and walk into blessing? It's all it takes. It's all it takes. God has given you opportunity. You're here this morning because God ordained that you are here. But you're here this morning, not only because he ordained that you be here, but so that you can understand that he has a blessing for you. And it's not too late. Amen? Let's bow our heads in the Lord. Father, we thank you for your word. Cause us to know your sweetness and your goodness. Lord, where we've said we won't go, Lord, turn us around and bring us back. Bring us to the vineyard. Bring us to your blessing.
He saw the best in me when everyone else around me.
And if we've said, I'll go, but we haven't, there's still opportunity.
Can I tell you one more time? I said, he saw the best in me.
Are you ready for blessing?
When everyone else around could only see the worst in me.
Listen to that song.
I wish I had a witness tonight. All I need is one.
See, Jesus is seeing the best in you.
Does anybody have that testimony? When folk walked you off, said you would never make it.
Are you ready? God sees the best in you. Don't worry about everybody around you seeing something else. You are valuable in his eyes.
Listen to this. See, he's mine, and I am his. It doesn't matter what I did. He only sees me for who I am. Does anybody know that tonight? Oh, see, he is mine, and I am his. Said it doesn't matter what I did.
Would you all stand with me?
See, he only sees me for who I am. Help me sing it. The word said that he is mine.
Do you believe who Jesus is? Are you his? Don't do this unless you mean it, but if you mean it, just lift your hands up to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm going to learn to walk in your blessing. I'm going to walk towards the vineyard. I'm going to go back and do what the Father has called me to do. And I'm going to walk in blessing. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, cause us to walk in your blessing. Cause us to walk in your presence. Cause us to walk in your power and your providence. Lord, as we walk into the vineyard to do the Father's will. Lord, the fields are white unto harvest. Let us become a harvester. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I mean, believe who he is. What he can do. Father, we thank you.
I'm so confused.
I want you to greet somebody and let them know that you love them and let Jesus be
loud and clear. So I follow through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't want to think, I may never understand, that my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I got is hurt and these four words. Thy will be done. Thy will be done. Thy This don't feel good right now, and I know you think of things I could never think about. It's hard to count it all joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God.